All right, thank you. You can check, check, check. Check, 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 testing.
Up here when we start? Or? Okay.
Check. And good morning, everyone, and welcome to Island Pond Baptist Church. It's good to see you all here this morning. So if you are online, I'm going to ask you, go ahead right now and go to the comments section of the stream and just say hello and then mention where you're watching from, whether it be Derry or up in Maine, if some of you I know are watching up in Maine. So wherever you're at, go ahead right now and say hello to the others there that are on the stream. If you're new here, I'd love to be able to hear from you. And so you can go to our website and then click on the contact button. That will take you right to the contact form down at the bottom of that page. You can fill that out and then click on the send button. That'll come right to me. So you can go ahead and do that right now. And as you are doing that, let me go ahead now and I'll read our call to worship, which is from Psalm chapter 108, and this is verses 1 through 4. My heart is steadfast, O God. I will sing and make melody with all my being. Awake, O harp and lyre, and I will awake the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations, for your steadfast love is great above the heavens. And your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Let's go ahead and pray this morning. Lord Jesus, we come to you now in the midst of a crazy time. Even here at Island Pond, where things are a little bit just out of rhythm right now. But in the midst of the craziness, Lord, we declare that you are in control. And so we thank you that in the midst of everything that's going on, You keep our hearts steadfast, as the psalmist says. We sing to you, Lord Jesus. We make a melody to you. And we thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We take this time now to praise you, for your steadfast love is great and above the heavens. And Lord Jesus, I lift up those that are watching this morning that are struggling in some way. I pray, God, that you will give peace to the anxious. I pray that you will give hope to the hopeless. I pray that you will give healing to those that are sick, wisdom to those who are confused or lost. And I pray for those that are spiritually lost that you would give faith, faith in you. So Lord, as we study your word in a little bit and as we sing songs praising you, may you be glorified, Lord Jesus. May you be exalted. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I want you to give a big Island Pond welcome in the comments section to the other Kyle. He normally leads in our evening service for some of the weeks, and he's going to be leading us this morning. And so, Kyle, I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to you.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. Arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. On heaven's mercy seat. should I sing praise to the King of Kings? You are my everything, and I will adore you. The darkness, your loving kindness. tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory. Bear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. 'Cause Jesus, yours is the victory.
And take the morning's offering, and so I'm going to give you all just an opportunity now to give online. And so before we do that, though, let me go ahead and pray for the offering. Father, I thank you for blessing us, and I thank you for all the blessings that you have given us. I lift up now, Lord, the offering that is given. I pray that it will be used to extend and to carry on the good work that you're doing through Island Pond and in the world, Lord. And so, Lord, may you take the gospel message that is being shared, and may you spread it, Lord. We lift up all the missionaries and ministries that are supported by our church. We pray for your blessing upon them. We pray for your protection upon them. And I pray, God, that you will encourage them in the days to come. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have given us. And now, in just the small amount that's given now, may you use it, Lord, for your glory. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'll go ahead and give you just about 30 seconds now to give online. And so you can go to our website and then click on giving, and that'll take you to our online giving portal. All right, go ahead and turn to the book of Galatians as we continue through our series in the book of Galatians. And today we're going to start out with just a little game. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to show you a picture, and I want you to guess whether or not this bug, insect, or whatever it may be, is going to eventually, when it grows up, fly. So let me go ahead. Let's bring up the first bug here. Will it fly? Go ahead. You can put in the comments right now. Will it fly or not? Yes or no? Let's see. All right. Let's find out. Is it going to fly? Yes, it will fly. It is the black swallowtail. The black swallowtail. Pretty cool. Pretty cool. All right. That's how the game goes. Here is the next one. Will it fly? So go ahead, I'm going to give you just a moment to put in your put in the comments whether it will fly or not, yes or no. Drum roll, please. Will it fly? Let's go to the next slide. No, it will not fly. That is a cockroach, and cockroaches will not fly. This is a little bit off subject here. I remember when I was on a mission trip in Africa with my college friends, with my college, and so a number of my friends, we were in a village in Africa, and so the only bathroom they had was a latrine out. You just basically, it was a big hole with a little wood over it. And so one night, one of the girls in my team went to the bathroom out there and screamed, and apparently a cockroach had jumped on her backside while she was going potty, and so they cannot fly, but they can jump, so be careful there when you're going potty. All right, let's go to the next one. Will it fly? This is a tough one. All right, next. Yes, it will fly. It is a Brahmin moth. That was a little tricky, wasn't it? Let's try this next one. Will it fly? I don't even know what in the world that is. I'm going to guess no, it will not fly. Let's go to the next slide and find out. Boom, it does fly. I don't even know how to pronounce that name, but that thing, Cecropia, maybe. You can give me a thumbs up or thumbs down in the comments if I pronounced it incorrectly. Cecropia, whatever, that is a flying thing. All right, I think we have one or two more. Will it fly? What do you think? Let's go to the next slide. No, it will not fly, but that is a wood frog, and it will jump. Okay, next one. Will it fly? That is an ugly thing. If I found that in my house, I'm not sure if it would be flying or not, whatever it turns out to be. Okay, next slide. Yes, it will fly. That is an Atticus Atlas. Okay, now we have one more. One more. It fly. Dum-ba-dum-ba-dum. Let's find out. Next slide. Yes, it will fly. That is a blue morpho butterfly. Now that you've had a bug lesson, you may be wondering, why did I tune in to Island Pond Baptist Church to the streaming if I'm going to see pictures of butterflies? Well, here's what I'm getting at here. I don't know about you, but some of those transformations were pretty incredible, weren't they? They went from, let's be honest, they went from being super ugly. Some of these little ones were just super, super ugly. And they actually turned out to be downright or pretty cool looking bugs later on. And so through some sort of miraculous process, they go from ugly, creepy, wiggling little things into beautiful butterflies or moths or whatever it may be. The reason I bring that up is because in our passage today, we're going to hear from Paul, who's going to be giving his testimony to the church in Galatia. And we're going to hear about how he goes from an ugly, mean terrorist into what I might call a beautiful missionary. And the more, though, than just these outward actions, we're going to see how he goes from full of hate to full of hope and love. And he's going to go from trying to earn his righteousness to letting Jesus make him righteous. Here's the beautiful thing. This is not just a story of, hey, look what God has done in my life. This is a story of, hey, look what God can do in your life as well. God can work powerfully, not just in the life of some person who turned out to be a missionary, but God can work powerfully in your life as well. Now, before I go any further, though, some of you who've been a Christian for a while, who've been Christians for a while, may be thinking, oh, there he goes again with just a basic message about Christianity. I want something deeper. And if that's you, I want to challenge you or encourage you to hold off to the end here, because I want to show you, at the end, I'll show you how this applies to those who have been longtime Christians as well. So let's go ahead now and let's dive into our passage this morning. And we're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 1, verses 10 to 24. But for the sake of time, I'm just going to be bringing out certain parts. So we're going to start in verse 11. For I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. Right here in verse 13, Paul is talking about what we call his former way of life, how he was devoutly opposed to Christians, so much so that he wanted them to die. In fact, in Acts chapter 7, the deacon Stephen was in the midst of being stoned to death, and Paul basically just says, here, stoners, I'm going to take your coats. I'll hold your coats for you while you stone him. In other words, he was encouraging them. He was cheering them on. He was approving of what they were doing. In Acts chapter 9, a few chapters later, we see in verses 1 and 2, it says, But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters of the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Notice that first part there. Paul says, or it says that Paul is literally breathing threats and murder against them. That's how much he hated the Christians. He wants them destroyed. And that's Paul's, what we call, his former life. I don't know about you, but that sounds miserable, doesn't it? That sounds miserable, where he's just full of hate and full of anger there. There's no happiness there. There's no joy. It's just hate all through. And here's what I want you to see from this part of the passage, that prior to Jesus, Paul's life was unhappy. And that's putting it, you may even say, Paul's life was full of hate. It was miserable. And the same is true for us as well, that prior to Jesus, there was some sort of emptiness going on in our life. There was some sort of unhappiness going on in our life, leaving us thinking, is that all there is? But what's interesting is that even though Paul was unhappy, he was successful. Look at the next verse, verse 14. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. We know from other passages that he studied under a prominent teacher, and he was successful in his work. And he worked hard at what he did. But this is what we may call worldly success. This success would not ultimately fulfill him. And sometimes we look at other people's lives and we look at what's going on maybe out on TV or across the street at our neighbors, and we think, wow, their life, that seems pretty good. And at least from one perspective, it might. But apart from Jesus, that is empty success. It leads to emptiness. It leads us wondering, is that all there is? Isn't there more in life? That's what happened to the theologian Martin Luther. This is hundreds and hundreds years ago. He had a tremendous impact on the lives of many, but it started out as one who was empty. As a teenager, he was sent off to school, and he was very successful, very smart guy. He earned his bachelorette and master's degree in the shortest time allowed by the university. And as he was planning and preparing to be a lawyer, he had a reputation for being well known for his public debating skills. But then one night, when he was 21 years old, he was walking somewhere, and he was outside, and there was a thunderstorm going on, and it got worse and worse, and the weather then got so bad that lightning struck right near him. And he was so afraid that he prayed to a saint that if he made it home safely, he would become a monk. Well, he made it home safely, so he then told his father that he would no longer pursue being a lawyer and he would become a monk. His father wasn't very happy about it, but Martin Luther pursued that path and he became a very successful monk. He plunged into prayer, into fasting, into what we might call the ascetic practices, such as going without sleep, enduring bone-chilling cold without a blanket, or as my wife likes to call, living at my house. Although she does have a blanket, but she calls it bone-chilling cold. He also would whip himself just because he was wanting to try to beat out the sin and beat out the bad stuff in his life. And he later commented saying, if anyone could have earned heaven by the life of a monk, it was I. But in the midst of the hard work, he still felt empty. He was constantly feeling as if he was not good enough, and he was constantly feeling and fearing that he was headed for hell. During this time, he was still a monk, and he was pursuing his doctorate degree. And when he was doing that, he was studying the Bible one day, preparing for a lecture on Psalms, and he came across this one verse that really just took hold of him. It's Romans chapter 1, verse 17, which says, "For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." And as he dwelled on that verse, it finally hit him that righteousness does not come by what he does, by his works, by whipping himself, by living in cold and without blankets. Righteousness doesn't come from anything of that. Righteousness comes from putting your faith in Jesus Christ And when he finally got it, he went from being a hard-working monk to being a hard-working theologian and pastor. He went from being empty to being full of hope. And though he was certainly not perfect and made mistakes in his life and said some things that hundreds of years later we're looking at saying, that's not so nice, God still mightily used him for the rest of his life. Now, going back to Paul was devout. Paul was successful. Paul was hardworking, but he was also empty, and his life was headed in the wrong direction. That was what he called his former way of life. But in verse 15, we're given one powerful word, and that's a word that we all need. And the word is but. But. Look at verse 15, talking about how he was leading up to his former way of life. He had messed up. But when he who had set me apart before I was born and who called me by his grace was pleased to reveal his son to me. Now listen, this is so important for us to understand. You see, before Jesus, his life was empty and he was headed to hell and he was spiritually bankrupt. But Jesus stepped in. And after Jesus stepped in, everything changed. Here's what I want you to see this morning. And I hope you don't get distracted here. Hopefully I didn't get too fancy with a little bit of word play. But what I want you to see is that we all need a big but moment. We all need a big but moment. Every one of us needs to realize that we are headed in the wrong direction. Every one of us needs to realize that we can't help ourselves, but Jesus can. Every one of us needs to realize that. And when we get to that point in our lives, we can have what I call the big but moment. It's the moment where you take where you take your emptiness and you hand it over to Jesus Christ. Turning back to verse 16, it says, by his grace was pleased to reveal his son to me. You see, it all comes back to Jesus. In essence, Jesus is the glue. He's the spiritual glue that holds this whole spiritual thing together. He is the primary object of what we believe. And that's why, if you've been downstairs in our fellowship hall, we worked on a backdrop over the past month. And the backdrop has a word, and the word does not say good works. The word does not say work harder. The word does not say read the Bible more. Though, you know what? I hope you read your Bible more. All these things are fine and good. It's good to do good works. But the word that's on the back of our backdrop there, downstairs in the fellowship hall, is Jesus. Jesus. Because Jesus is the one who saves. He is the object of our faith. Of our salvation, and he is the one that we put our trust in. He is the one that we put our hope in. He is the one that we need to focus on. It is on Jesus and Jesus alone. Let me ask then, how did Paul turn from a terrorist into a missionary? How did he go from being empty, from being unhappy? He had his big but moment because Jesus saved him. Jesus saved him. Now listen closely. There are a lot of buts out there. There are a lot of other things and people out there. There are a lot of things that will try to tell you how to find true happiness. A lot of other things out there that are going to say, this is the big but. But I want to tell you, and I hope you're not offended by what I'm about to say here in church, all other butts are full of poop. They're full of poop, and don't take my word for it. I want you to take Paul's words for it in Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 and 8. Paul says, and I'll put it here on the screen, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ. That word there that Paul in the ESV used, rubbish, literally means waste or poop. In the King James Version, it's descriptively called dung. And so Paul said first, not me. You can look in other places, you can turn to other things, you can turn to other philosophies, other religions, but all these buts lead to nothing but waste, but dung, but poop. All other buts are full of poop. So church, don't follow the wrong but, because it will lead you down an empty road. I remember when I was maybe 7 years old, we went up to my uncle's farm. And on my uncle's farm, my brothers and I were walking around the cow milking area. I don't even know what it's called. Inside, and all the cows were lined up. But behind the cows was this area that collects all the poop. And for some reason, I started walking back and forth among them. And somehow I slipped. And I slipped right into the poop. And I was covered in poop. And my parents had to take me. They didn't take me inside. They got a hose. And they started spraying me off outside and out there. And I remember just feeling disgusting in that. Again, when you follow something other than Jesus Christ, when you turn to another but moment, it's going to lead to a life of poop. Now, with that in mind, I promised that I would talk to you that if you've been a Christian for a while, how does this apply to you? How does this apply to your life? Maybe you've been a Christian for 10 or 20 or even 50 years. Let me read this last part. Verse 16, that I might preach him among the Gentiles. The Gentiles are the non-Jews. I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem. Verse 22, and I was still unknown in person to the churches in Judea that are in Christ. They only were hearing it said, he who used to persecute us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy, and they glorify God because of me. So Paul's trying to tell them that that he didn't receive the message of Jesus Christ just off by another apostle. It wasn't like someone taught it to him. He was given it to him. It was given to him separately, and then he met up with the other apostles, and it turns out that they had the same message. But in the midst of all of that, let's not miss those verses that I pointed out there. He says that he received the message in order that he received the good news of Jesus Christ in order that he might preach Jesus among the Gentiles. Paul was saved by Jesus so that he might share the good news of Jesus. And the same is true for us as well. Some of you have known the good news for years, and it's so easy to think, that's something that I've moved on from. I've moved on from the basic message. But the basic message of Jesus, the gospel message, the message that Jesus saves you from your sins and gave you new life through him, is not the entry point into Christianity, like believe this and then go on your way. No, the basic message of Jesus is the life we are called to live out. Let me say it again. The basic message of Jesus is the life we are called to live out. After Paul was saved, he didn't just say, wow, Jesus is amazing, and now he then went on his way. No, instead, once Paul was saved, he said, Jesus saved me, and it's completely changed my life, and now I'm going to go share that message with other people. You see, some of us have turned to Christianity, and we've thought that Christianity then is just one part of our life. It's just one subject in our school. And we think, oh, I'm, you know, on Sunday I'm going to go to the Christian class, to the subject of that one part of my life. But we can't think of Christianity, of the gospel message, as just one part of our life. Because the life of being a Christian is not one class. It's the entire school. Everything comes under that. A while back, I shared this illustration, and actually my son told me that I've shared it a couple times since then. So if this has come up before, I apologize. But many of us think of Christianity like it's a cruise ship. We get on board, and then everything, once we get on board, is for us. I remember getting on a Disney cruise one time, and as we walked on, people started clapping. The workers were clapping for us as we came on. And they did that for the thousands of people that would walk on to the cruise ship. That's because when you're on a cruise ship, everything is for you. You're there to be comfortable. You're there to enjoy yourself. You're there to eat as much food as you want and to have a great time. But that is not what the Christian life is. The Christian life is not a cruise ship. The Christian life is like being on a destroyer. It's like being on a battleship. It's when your entire life's focus is not on your comfort, but it's on, not on your preferences. It's on the it's on the mission of Jesus Christ. It's being on a mission and making sure that that mission takes priority, not your comfort, not your benefits, not anything else. It's the mission that you've been given. I like how Peter says it in 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. And why is that? That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And that's exactly what Paul is saying as well. Now, let's be honest, though, that's not easy. It's not easy to walk around saying life does not revolve around me. It revolves around something else, something that's greater than me. It's not easy to say that I'm not the most important person. But that's what Jesus wants for you. He wants you to give him your entire life. And that's the case if you become a Christian today. And that was the case if you became a Christian 50 years ago. This does not revolve around us. We need to take the gospel message and let it come into our life so much that it just begins to flow out as the mission of our life. Let me close with the story about Adoniram Judson. He was born in the late 18th century in Massachusetts. His father was a Congregationalist pastor. And he went on to attend Brown University, and he had grown up a Christian, but when he got to Brown University, he met another guy named Jacob Eames. He was a fellow student, and Jacob Eames was a deist. He was not a Christian. And Jacob Eames, as Judson became more and closer and closer friends with him, eventually became a deist as well. He renounced his faith in Jesus Christ and no longer followed Jesus. Now, this went on for a couple of years, and Judson kept it quiet with his parents until one day he announced, when he was 20 years old, he announced to his parents that he was no longer a Christian. He had walked away from Christianity, and he was going to pursue a career in theater. And so his parents were heartbroken, but he followed that path, and he moved down to New York. But on his way, that he was traveling down to New York. He was tired one night, and he came across an inn where he wanted to stay the night. When he tried to check in, the innkeeper said, "This probably isn't a great place to stay tonight. We only have one room left, and it's next door to a guy that's dying. And so you probably shouldn't stay here." But Judson said, "I'm so tired, I'm going to stay here tonight. So I'll take the room. So he went up to his room, and sure enough, all night long, he heard the sounds of the dying man next to him, of the groans and the agony and all that. And it made him start to question his own decisions about renouncing his faith in Jesus Christ. But he made it through the night. And the next morning, he got up and got ready to go out. And he, just out of curiosity, he asked the innkeeper as he was leaving, "What happened to the man who was next door to me?" And the innkeeper said, "He died." And then said, did you know him? And the innkeeper said he didn't know him, but he was some young man from Providence, a college student. His name was Jacob Eames. Judson stopped. He didn't realize that right next door to him was his friend who had talked him out of faith in Jesus Christ, was lying in bed in agony, dying by himself, next door to him. Well, this obviously rocked Judson's life, and he altered his life at that point, and he put his faith in Jesus Christ. He ended up going to seminary, and he shortly after he graduated from seminary, he got married, and he moved overseas to become a missionary. He was one of the first missionaries to leave the North American continent to go overseas to Asia. And he headed for India, but India wouldn't let him in, and so he ended up in Burma. And for 38 years in Burma, he preached the good news of Jesus Christ, and he worked on translating the Bible into the Burmese language. And he encountered hardship after hardship, but he would not stop. He encountered his first wife dying, and then his second wife dying, and many of his kids dying over there. And he was in prison multiple times, he was in prison for quite a while. And all of this, you would think that he would say, "Forget this, I'm going home to a more comfortable life." But he knew that the gospel message had changed his life, and he wanted the Burmese people to hear it as well. And even by the end of his life, not a huge amount of people through 38 years of work came to know Jesus during his life. Only about 8,000 had put their faith in Christ through 38 years as a missionary. But as he was getting ready, near the end of his life, he finished translating the Bible in the Burmese language. And now, 170 years later, that is still the only Bible that is translated into their language. And I read an article this week that talked about how it was through the impact of the Bible and through the impact of his life, even though he didn't see a massive amount from his labors and through all the suffering that he experienced in 38 years there. Now, 170 years later, they can attribute about 6 million people who have put their faith in Jesus Christ over the years thanks to his efforts. You see, Adoniram Judson decided that the life of the gospel was not about him. It was not about just saying, "I believe in Jesus, I'm going to go on and do my own thing." No, he said, "Jesus has saved me. Now I'm going to go and tell others about it." He was living out the gospel message to others. I'm not telling you that one day you're going to become a missionary overseas. But I am telling you that every one of us who have been changed by Jesus are called to be missionaries right where we're at. And so we are called not just to take the message and do nothing, we are called to take the message and live it out in our family, live it out in our community, live it out in the world. More than our comfort, more than anything else, we are called to live out the message of Jesus Christ. So I want to challenge you today, will you do that? Will you do that? If there's sin in your life, I want to challenge you to let's get it out. Get rid of it in your life right now and be committed to let Jesus live in and through you. I want to go ahead now and take a moment to pray as we finish up the service. Before I pray, I want to ask, is there anyone here that has never put their faith in Jesus Christ? And if you've never put your faith in Jesus Christ, then even right now, you can turn to him. The Bible says that if you will call out to him, ask him to be the Lord of your life, you say, "Lord, I need you. I can't do anything on my own. The Bible says that he will come and save you. So I want to encourage you right now, even right now, go and turn to him. And maybe you've done that years ago, but you're recognizing that you're not living out the gospel message in your life like you should. So I want to take just about 20 seconds. We're not going to have a closing song, so we're going to take about 20 seconds now of just quiet and of silence. We're going to spend a moment now praying, asking God to help us to live out the message that he's so powerfully worked in our life. Let's go ahead now and spend a moment in quiet. Father, I pray for each person that's listening to the message right now. I pray that you will help them, not just to accept your message, I want them to do that, but to then take the message and live it out. And Lord, maybe they're not going to go to Burma or Bhutan or Bangladesh, but Lord, you're calling them to reach out to their neighbor, to their coworker, to their child. So Lord, may we do that. May we do that today. May we live out the message that you have done in us. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, we're going to go ahead and wrap up the service now. Let me close with a couple of quick announcements. If you did pray with me, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, or if you just need prayer for something, you can go right to our website and click on the contact button. There's a form right there. You can fill it out. It'll come right to me, and I'll be in touch with you this week. Love to be able to help you to start your journey in your life of faith in Jesus Christ. In the upcoming weeks, we're going to continue having the 9:30 drive-in service in the parking lot, the 10:30 sanctuary service, and then we also have a 6 p.m. service in the evening on Sundays, which is the morning service but at night. Now, this week, obviously, is a little different. I will be sending out an email midweek to let you know what's going to happen next week. And so just be in touch. By the way, if you do not get our emails, you can go right to our website, scroll all the way down to the bottom, and there's a little link that you can fill out that says get announcements by email. And so I would encourage you, that's the best way to get the most important announcements that we send out as a church. And so go ahead and make sure you do that. Two other quick announcements. First of all, marriage small group. That is starting tomorrow. And actually, you know what? I just decided, because of everything that's happening this week, we're going to start it next week. So it's going to be starting next week, the 28th of September. And that'll be at 7:45 on Monday evenings on Zoom. And so you can contact the office to sign up for that. So marriage small group, we're not the 21st, but the 28th. Yeah, thank you. My son there is crossing out the 21 and doing the 28th. Thank you. Last, we are hiring a second church custodian. And so if you are interested in working just a little bit, it's going to be for 5 hours per week, flexible hours, mostly flexible hours. And so if you're interested in being considered for that position, contact the office for that. Well, let me close with a benediction now from Ephesians chapter 3. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Well, I hope you all have a wonderful week. And hopefully next week we will be back here in person in the sanctuary. And I will see you then.